and welcome to Indian Express Opinion. Our top story today is the potential elevation of Rahul Gandhi to the presidentship of the Congress Party and what this means for national politics. I have with me Manoj CG, crack correspondent covering the Congress Party for the Indian Express. Manoj, what does this mean? Rahul has been the prince in waiting for such a long time. Is he now going to be king?
Yes, he should be next month.
Okay.
Today the Congress Working Committee met.
Yeah.
And they officially announced the election schedule for the post of the Congress President.
What are these dates?
They will notify the election on December 1st.
Uh-huh.
And December 4th is the last date of filing of nominations.
All right.
So there is only one nomination, which means if Rahul Gandhi is the only person
who is filing
his nomination. Yeah, but they will not announce it right away. There's a process. The scrutiny is on 5th.
Uh-huh.
And the withdrawal is on 11th.
All right.
So we can expect the official announcement on 11th.
Mm-hmm.
And if they waive off this withdrawal period, then on 5th itself. That means before the first phase of polling in Gujarat takes place.
Exactly. So just a few days before the first phase of polling in Gujarat. But I will come to that a little bit later. Manoj, tell me, Sonia Gandhi has been president of the Congress Party since 1998. Now, it's 19 years.
She's the longest serving president of the Congress.
Right. So why is it that it's taken her so long to hand over the reins? And is it that she wasn't comfortable, or her party men weren't that comfortable with Rahul, and that now the time has come to make the change?
It's a mix of both. Mm-hmm. You know, after 2014, the official reason, and to some extent it's right also, her health is failing.
Uh-huh.
And secondly, the party man was also not that willing.
Her health is failing. Let me ask you about that. Her health isn't that good?
No, she has been in and out of hospital for some time. She has asthmatic problems and all those related problems.
Mm-hmm.
So she has taken now, in the last 2 years, a deliberate backseat and let Rahul be on the forefront.
Right.
So that he deals with different levels of party leaders, the inhibitions that many of them had, that also gets cleared.
Mm-hmm.
Because Sonia, you know, she has been a consensus player.
Yeah.
She, right from 98, never really disrupted the structure of the Congress.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it comes to factional feud in states or problems, she's always, you know, did not take sides.
Give me an example of that.
In several states, in one state, maybe you take Kerala.
Yeah.
There was a factional fight between two leaders.
Mm-hmm. Which ones?
Long ago it was Karunakaran and Antony.
Okay.
Right from then, she will always accommodate.
Mm-hmm.
One here, one there, give some to him, give some to him.
Mm-hmm.
So she will never disrupt the
whole
structure.
Keep both factions happy.
Keep both factions happy. She, you know, that is the consensus player that she has been.
Mm-hmm.
But Rahul, you know, ever since he became General Secretary in 2008, he had these ideas, you know, about bringing an element of meritocracy into the party. Because when he was traveling as a General Secretary, he was in charge of Youth Congress and NSUI. He was traveling across the state. So one complaint that he heard from, you know, every state is that there are some entrenched players, factions. So the post office bearers, MLA tickets, MP tickets, they corner that.
Right.
So the people who are not in any of these coteries,
they don't get an opportunity,
they don't get an opportunity
to come in front.
So first he introduced elections in Youth Congress. He called it the democratization. So when you open an organization for elections, not the elections that the Congress is doing right now,
right,
this is mainly consensus.
Yeah.
You put candidates, get votes, and the person who gets the largest vote, the largest number of votes, become the president.
Yes.
Youth Congress president. That really was unsettling for several top leaders.
But why was that?
Because
it was a good thing, wasn't it, that there was a reform taking place in India's largest political party.
You may think it as a reform.
Mm-hmm.
But for entrenched players, it's somebody who is totally out of their control.
So that made them insecure.
That made them insecure. For example, they rigged that also. In Himachal and Uttarakhand, Mr. Rawat and Veerbhadra Singh ensured that their sons become the Congress president.
Right. So the consolidation of dynasty was taking place even as the insecurity in these states.
But they have a point also. Rahul himself is a dynast.
Exactly. That was my next question.
Yeah. So they had a point also there. How can you allow?
So how did he answer that?
He said then, let dynast or not dynast. If Veerbhadra Singh's son want to become the Youth Congress president, he get the largest number of votes, let him be.
Mm-hmm.
So he's the Youth Congress president. He was till the elections, assembly elections, he resigned. Same with Rawat's son, Harish Rawat's son in Uttarakhand. So whosoever gets the largest number of votes, they become the Congress president.
So did that happen then?
Was it happened, but mostly did not happen the way he wanted. Then in 2014, before the Lok Sabha elections, he had this primary exercise.
That's right.
You know, 15 Lok
Sabha. That was pretty much a disaster, wasn't it?
It was a disaster, but the idea was good. In the sense, he picked 15 Lok Sabha seats and said, anybody who wants to contest as a Congress candidate, there was an electoral college of office bearers, district, booth, block and all. Let all of them vote, and whosoever gets the largest number of votes, he becomes the Congress candidate.
Right.
But that, in a party like a Congress, where ticket distribution is one way of, you know,
exactly,
handling
consolidating control,
yeah,
power
and all.
Yeah.
So these sort of things, one set of leadership was, you know, they were really uncomfortable. But now, ever since 2014, Rahul has also changed in that sense.
In what way?
He has become more practical. You know, if you remember in his Berkeley address, he said...
At the US, which was a couple of months ago.
Yes. Yeah. He said in as many as words that, you know, now I have become practical. We cannot shun anybody. So in the last 6 months, the appointments that Congress has made as office bearers, you can see an Ashok Gehlot becoming an ICC General Secretary in charge of Gujarat.
That's right.
An RPN Singh in charge of Jharkhand. KC Venugopal in charge of Karnataka, young person. At the same time, you know, old and young, Shinde, Sushil Kumar Shinde in charge of Himachal Pradesh.
Yes.
So he's accommodating old, young. He is now slowly moving into that Sonia Gandhi kind of setup where he keeps everybody happy.
So there was a lot of speculation that the so-called old guard, whether it was Ahmed Patel, Ghulam Nabi Azad, a lot of the older sort of Congress leaders who have been in these positions of power for several decades, were not happy with the way Rahul was sort of steamrolling politics as a general secretary.
That you can say was the case maybe a couple of years ago. Ever since the beating that they took in 2014, that thing has changed in the party.
Okay.
So Rahul has also realized, the old guard, as we call it, they have also realized now
that they better hang together
because
then the whole party will.
No hope.
Okay.
So now Rahul also accommodates the interest. Even the I don't expect any major purge in the party when it comes to these senior old leaders. Maybe one or two here and there, but no.
But and also Ahmed Patel won his Rajya Sabha election by the by the brink of it was so close.
Backed him to the hill during that time also.
So do people now, with the potential elevation of Rahul as the president, do people still talk about the fact that this is yet another dynasty who's going to take over the head, becoming the head of India's largest political party?
That question will invariably come up. Obviously, the BJP will now
rub it in.
Yeah, they will rub it in, saying, see, the Congress doesn't have any other leaders. You have to be in a Gandhi.
It's a legitimate question, isn't it?
It's a legitimate question, but it's ultimately the prerogative of the party to decide if there is an election. According to the Congress Constitution.
So explain to me, Manoj, as you know, we call ourselves a democracy, we've been a republic now. It's India's 70th year of independence. In its 70th year, do you not feel that there's something odd about the fact that the largest political party in the country is headed by a dynast?
But that is the glue which holds the Congress together.
In what way?
The final arbiter is a Gandhi. You know, take
in
an
what
example.
Way? Explain to me.
Take
what happens if there is no Gandhi at the center?
The party's past has shown that whenever a non-Gandhi is a president, be it P.V. Narasimha Rao, there was a split. N.D. Tiwari, Arjun Singh, Sheila Deekshit, all of them went out. Then came the Kesari era. Again, there was a split. Against Kesari fought Sharad Pawar and Rajesh Pailet for the post of Congress president. So, for them, you can argue, we can argue, but for the Congress party, Gandhi is the final arbiter. You know, any state, any issue, two leaders are fighting, they come to Delhi, the high command, the so-called high command calls them, and if Sonia or Rahul, they takes a call, 70 to 80% they accept, go back. 20 to 30% that person may leave the party. But if it's a non-Gandhi, these people, why would they accept?
So a lot of people like, say, Himanta Biswa Sarma in Assam, he had a very public falling out with Rahul when he accused him of not treating him well. Or there were several other Congress leaders who have left the party because they've been sick these last few years, even in the run-up to the 2014 elections and afterwards, that Rahul doesn't have time for them. That he's not a 24-hour full-time politician.
He is not a natural politician. his natural liking, maybe not towards politics, but I think in the last couple of years that has changed.
Okay.
So this Himanta Biswa Sarma episode, there is one angle which the Himanta Biswa Sarma angle, but he has not treated properly and all. There is another angle which is Tarun Gogoi, a veteran 80-year-old chief minister. Rahul said he will continue, he will lead the party into elections, we lose or we win.
Right.
So there, the so-called old guard, Rahul Gandhi, was siding with an old guard.
That's right. He was deferring to the old guard.
Yeah.
And he didn't want to take Himanta's side.
So, and Himanta obviously, and at least many of the Congress leaders say, he was again insecure, maybe because of the rise of Mr. Gogoi's son.
Mm-hmm.
So these are all personal
rivalries and
clashes that happened. These are not ideological.
So do people still ask Rahul about the fact that as the dynasty, I mean, I know I am pressing this point about the fact that he is going to inherit the job. I mean, why should he inherit the job?
Because the party wants him to.
Absolutely. But do people in the party ask this question, even if it's off the record or under, you know, behind the scenes?
What I have seen is that, you know, about Sonia Gandhi, even off the record, I have rarely heard a congressman criticizing her.
Why? Because they feel that they have a lot of affection for her.
It's affection, maybe.
Yeah. And she held the party together in very dire circumstances.
Troubled times.
Yeah.
Whereas when it comes to Rahul, people have spoken against him on record, off record. Maybe it's his age. Maybe he hasn't developed that kind of rapport with all the leaders across the board. So it's his time now to prove whether he is good enough to be the Congress president, the president of India's largest
political. Do you think
party.
He wants it? Do you think he hungers
he,
for the job?
No. Initially, he was reluctant. Now, I think he has told people close to him that he wants to take over. He wants to lead the party into the elections in 2019. Very clear on that.
So, in Gujarat, we've seen a new Rahul Gandhi. What do you make of this avatar? You know, reaching out to the non-BJP opposition, whether it's Alpesh Thakur or Hardik Patel.
Gujarat being Prime Minister's home state, there is much at stake for the Congress there.
In this election.
That will give a message. Even if they manage to, you know, bring down the BJP's number of seats,
right,
and if they get a shot at power, nothing like that. So, you know, the elections were happening simultaneously in Gujarat as well as in Himachal Pradesh.
That's right.
Rahul spent 12 days so far in Gujarat and only 2 days in Himachal.
Okay.
So, both from a Congress point of view, uphill battle. Both of them are uphill battles. You know, one, there is a BJP, a strong BJP machinery in Gujarat, which you have to surmount. And in Himachal, there's a huge anti-incumbency against the government. So, from Congress point of view, both of them are difficult, really difficult battles. But he chose Gujarat.
Right.
That shows a change in Rahul, you know, an appetite to take risks now.
Is that what his close confidants say, that he's willing to take these risks?
That he's willing to bite
the bullet in a sense?
That is what the Congress would project the new Rahul to be. You know, he is willing to take risks. He is putting, you know, he at stake in Gujarat is Rahul.
What is your assessment, Manoj? What do you think? How are the people responding to this new Rahul?
No, at least when it comes to, you know, public interactions, public meetings, rallies and all in Gujarat, the crowd so far has been surprising, you know. Even the Congress did not expect such surge in crowds.
Right.
But the big question is whether it will
whether it's an anti-Modi or anti-BJP or whether it's a pro-Congress, pro-Rahul.
Because in 2012 also, there was this big, you know, sense of political circles that an upset is on the cards. Mm-hmm. But it did not happen.
Right.
BJP lost, if I remember correctly, 2 or 3 seats than 2007. So the big question is whether the crowds which are, you know, coming to Rahul's rallies,
whether it will translate into votes or not.
Into votes,
okay.
Help the Congress come to power. At least from a caste point of view, a caste matrix, the Congress kind of is in a comfortable position.
In what way? Explain this to us.
You know, the tribals, Chotubhai Vasava, the JDU leader is with them.
Yes.
Congress can always bang on the Muslim, the minority votes there. The Patidars, another influential section, he has struck a deal with Hardik Patel.
Mm-hmm.
Alpesh Thakur brings in the upper caste, Thakur votes. And you have Jignesh Mevani working, campaigning among Dalits.
So on paper, at least, there is a possible coalition, yes. A probable coalition that could translate into something. Nobody knows what exactly. So I have to ask you the sister question, Manoj. Do you think that Priyanka Gandhi will ever join politics? Because we keep, you know, we're obsessed with this Rahul versus Priyanka or with Priyanka sort of question. What do you think now?
That's a million-dollar question because, you know, nobody in the Congress really knows whether she would
she's
join
interested
politics,
or not.
She's interested or not. Mm-hmm. All they assume is that, or hope is that she may contest the next elections in 2019 because Sonia Gandhi, in all likelihood, may not contest from Raebareli again.
Right.
So the congressmen are hoping, rather praying, that she fights the Lok Sabha seat in Uttar Pradesh.
But in any case, clearly the mother has picked the son. And I thank you, Manoj, for your time. I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there. Whether you want to call it Putramo or whether the Congress party has come to the conclusion now, or Sonia Gandhi has come to the realization that it's time to hand over the reins to her son, Rahul Gandhi, who will perhaps very soon be the new president of the largest political party, the Grand Old Party of India. Thank you so much for watching.